creation cries. Holy, you are lifted high.
Bring you flowing from the grave.
to know the weaknesses I see. Many will be stripped away by the power of your love.
With all my heart and soul, with all my
strength and love to worship as your glory fills this place. One thing that I desire in my life, Lord, to thirst and hunger after you alone, with all my heart and soul, with all my strength and love, to worship as your glory fill this place. Deeper in love with you, deeper in love with you, I love you more than anything in love. Deeper in love with you, deeper in love.
This is a time when we put a little spotlight on our moms for their amazing sacrificial love that they bestowed on all of us. So may you bless them accordingly. And as we continue to worship, give our offering to you, may you instill in our hearts that we ought to give freely and willingly and cheerfully. So may you use our offering for your glory. And help us, O Lord, as we listen to your message, speak through your may I be your mouthpiece so that you will be glorified and that you will be highlighted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Today is perhaps many times in worship. I'm going to give you permission to use your phone. Our passage today is from Titus chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Let me read that over with you. So if you have your Bible or phone, turn your Bible to Titus chapter 2. Verse 1. You, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. Teach the ordinary men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Likewise, teach the ordinary women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can urge the younger women to love their husband and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about you, about us. Teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them, but to show that they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching of our God, our Savior, attractive. Amen. There were two churches during the 1800s that led a spiritual movement in England. Two churches were located in London. One was Metropolitan Tabernacle Church, spearheaded by Charles Spurgeon. You may have heard of his name. He is better known as the Prince of Preaching, because he was famous for preaching great messages. Even today, seminary students, they study Charles Spurgeon when they go to preaching classes. Another church was London Westminster Church, spearheaded by G. Campbell Morgan and Martin Lloyd-Jones. Some of you may have heard about their names. All pastors, I'm pretty sure, have heard about their names, because they were great pastors, great preachers. But these two churches, they had great buildings. It was a mega church before a mega church. They had great pastors giving wonderful Sunday messages. But moreover, they were passionate about spreading the gospel. They focused on sharing Jesus Christ. So God used these two churches to bring spiritual movement throughout the country. And we have to remember that, because from the very inception of the first church in Jerusalem, God was focused on one thing, that is to make Jesus Christ known. Yes, we come together, we worship, we fellowship, we study, we praise, all those things, you know, they are all great things. But the true essence of the church is to share Jesus Christ. Lest we forget, we exist to glorify God. Churches today exist to share Jesus Christ. We have to shine, put some spotlight on Jesus Christ. As we go to work, as we go to school, as we live our daily lives at home, we have to shine Jesus Christ. King Solomon built a magnificent temple. According to the Bible, he invested a whole lot of time and energy and money. It took him 7 years. Solomon was known for building beautiful buildings. It took him 7 years to build God's temple. In the temple, there is a holy place and the Holy of Holies. Little bigger than half of the football field. So not very big, and yet he hoarded his money. He was the wealthiest king at the time. According to my amateur calculation, in today's money, he spent about $3 billion building God's temple. That's a lot of money for a small space. But this temple was only able to shine God's glory when they obeyed God, when they followed God's commands. That's when God used this beautiful temple to reveal his glory. Otherwise, this temple was nothing. It's just a waste of money. In fact, it was destroyed by Babylonians. After 70 years, when they came back from Babylon exile, led by Zerubbabel and Ezra, they built smaller temples. You know, when they came back from their exile, they didn't have a whole lot of money, they didn't have a whole lot of materials, but they still pressed on to build God's temple. Even though this was a smaller in size, much smaller than Solomon's beautiful temple, they were still able to shine God's glory because they were willing to honor God. They were willing to follow God. And that's something that we have to remember today. We need to put God first. When we come to church, that has to be our main focal point. We could do other things, but all other things are part of the process so that we could do this, and that is to share Jesus Christ. I've been observing churches pretty much day one when I became a pastor. And I try to be a historian of churches. You know, all the churches that God used, God focused on one thing. Sharing about Jesus Christ and nothing more. It's not complicated. Apostle Paul tried. He was highly educated, right? When he went to Athens, he tried to reason with them. And in fact, he was so smart, he was able to outsmart them and provide enough proof so that the people said, okay, Paul, we know you're smart, but guess what? We're still not going to believe you. So Paul was just destroyed. He was destroyed. So when he went to the next city, Corinth, he realized, I need to make it simple. I need to just share Jesus Christ. That he came to die for all sinners. And when he died, he opened doors to everyone. Whoever accepts him as their personal savior, they will have eternal life. He just made it simple. There is a power in the name of Jesus Christ. When we bring Jesus Christ into our conversation, when we bring Jesus Christ into our daily lives, he will do the rest. He will shine himself. We just have to bring him. By nature, when we share Jesus Christ, we can't help but to be enlightened, to make a choice to confront him, whether to accept him or to reject him. That's his responsibility. Our responsibility is just put a little spotlight on Jesus Christ. Last week in chapter 1, end of chapter 1, we talked about how Paul wrote to Titus to raise leaders within the church, right? Elders. You train them and you grow together so they could lead God's church. To do what? And that's the same question we have to ask today. Especially going through the pandemic, you know what I observed? Even Christians don't come to church anymore. In fact, last 5 years, church has been declining so rapidly. It's just alarming. Christians don't come to church. They want to stay home and worship through online. Let alone sharing Jesus Christ. No, this is comfortable. This is what I want. This is how I'm going to worship. As if they have right to dictate how they will worship and serve God. We don't have that right, folks. It's something that church has to embrace. We have to go back to the very basic ministry that God has entrusted to us, and that is to share Jesus Christ. It's not complicated. It was never meant to be complicated. It was supposed to be simple, even for the children, to go and share Jesus Christ. On top of that, God gave all of us spiritual gifts. So when we exercise our gifts in the church, that should propel us to do what? To go and share Jesus Christ. Becoming mature and complete, not lacking anything, to share Jesus Christ. And folks, this is where exciting things happen in our spiritual life. You could go to church all your life, but guess what? If you don't get to the next level, we're just going to grow tired of church. The same old mundane thing. You come to church on Sunday, yeah, you dress up a little bit, and you pretend, you smile, you try to do good things, cordial things, and then you go home. And after a while, you're like, okay, maybe I don't have to go this Sunday. It's great, but you see, it isn't until we go to the next step. We apply our faith and listen to God and try to share Jesus Christ, God intervenes. God goes with us. And that's when we experience miracles, encounter Jesus' empowerment. This is where we need to be. If we don't get there, we're going to just stay here and maybe some, like so many other Christians today, okay, maybe I'll just worship at home. It's better than nothing. It's still good that they're worshiping, but not as good as when they come to worship God, to encourage one another, so that we could go and share Jesus Christ. This is where things happen. We need to get to this level. Today we had a special Bible study, or I should say, special presentation. We had a doctor, Zhang, explaining about illicit drugs. And I learned that there is a positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement from taking those drugs, and that just causes you to get dependent on this drug and so on and so forth. I don't know the whole detail, but it just sounded like that. Now I keep thinking, well, what about our Christian life? We have to experience something positive, experience, reinforcement. So as we share the gospel, sometimes you will stumble and there might be some negative reinforcement. But all these things will become our memory, our experience. And the fact that this is what God wants us to do and where God wants us to be, that assurance will cause us to press on with that ministry. And that's where the joy is. Folks, this is great. I love fellowship. I love eating food and sharing laughters. I want to have that. But if that does not lead to this, then we're going to be deprived of that experience. The way we grow is to get here. We need to do all these things to get here, to spread the gospel, to share Jesus Christ. And I urge you and me to do a little more. This is a song that most of us sing. If you're old enough, like me, you'll remember this song. Or if you're really into praising, you'll know this song. Shine, Jesus, shine. Sunday school song. It goes something like this. Lord, the light of your love is shining. In the midst of the darkness, shine. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Everything about this song is shining Jesus Christ. When we receive his light, God will use us to shine his light. See, we have to decrease more and more and more and allow God to shine through us. Again, it's not complicated. Charles Spurgeon grew up in a Christian family. His father was a preacher, his grandfather was a preacher, but he was still struggling. As a teenager, he tried to, you know, read the Bible. He tried to follow God. He was struggling, just like a typical teenager. As he was traveling with his family, they had to stop to worship God because of the weather. There was a big snowstorm and they couldn't move, so they checked in and thank God there was a small church in front of them, so they attended this church. Because of the storm, 20, you know, dozen people also came to this church. The pastor couldn't even make it to church that Sunday. So these, you know, dozen people or so, okay, we still have to worship God. So they pull out their hymnals and they sang and all those things, but they keep thinking, who's going to preach today? Who's going to preach today? And God just put a burden on one of the members. So he got up and he just said, you know, I'm not a preacher, as you know, and I don't know how to preach. But somehow God told me to say this today. Look upon Jesus. We just have to look upon Jesus. Like when you want to cry out to someone, look upon Jesus. When you need someone, look upon Jesus. And then he pointed to Charles Spurgeon, teenager boy. Hey, young man, look upon Jesus. And somehow, that hit Spurgeon's heart. That convicted him. He was, okay, I've been hearing Bible all my life, and I thought I had to do this in order to be saved. But what? Now I got it. I just have to look upon Jesus. I mean, that's a true story. So that Sunday, he received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Look upon Jesus. It's not complicated. It's not supposed to. We have simple job. and that is to shine Jesus. We have to look up on Jesus, and we have to help others to look up on Jesus as well. And I pray that we could focus on this together. Just one experience you will never forget. Again, going back to that illicit drug presentation, one experience with one of those drugs, there's a high chance you're going to get hooked. You're going to get addicted. Or at least you're going to remember that experience for the rest of your life. That's what she said. And this is the same, folks. When you experience leading someone to Christ, you will never forget that. When you become part of that experience, you would want to experience that again and again and again. And there is certain joy that comes within that utterly satisfies you, because you're doing God's work. And because you know God is pleased with you. Folks, we have to go here. We have to try this. Whether we succeed or unsucceed, that's not up to us. We just have to present Jesus. Just shine Jesus. It's up to God. He's going to do the rest. We'll gain experience. Positive reinforcement. Sometimes even negative, but it's okay. What will make our church great? What will make all the churches in Edmond great? I've seen big churches with beautiful buildings. But if they don't focus on this, they're not going to be great. It's not the size of the church. It's the heart of the people who are willing to share Jesus Christ. Going back to verses 9 and 10, it says, teach slaves. So Paul talks about older men, older women, younger men, younger women. And then he ends with slaves. Teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything. To try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them, not to show that they can be foolish first, so that in every way they will make the teaching of our God our Savior attractive. Granted, slaves during this time was not like the slaves that we know in our country. They had some freedom, but still they're in unfavorable circumstances. If anything, they should take advantage of situations so they could provide themselves with the better opportunities, right? Paul is addressing them for this most important task. Yeah, it's for everybody, but still, he's connecting the most important point of this passage with the slaves who are in unfavorable circumstances. I found that a little odd. Because this is not supposed to be that difficult. It is difficult if you try to do it yourselves. But if you rely on God, what Sam said here a couple times, nothing is impossible with God. Amen?
Amen.
The word attractive is interesting because that's where we get the Greek word kosmeo. That's where we get the English word cosmetics. And ladies, you know this more than us. When you put a little makeup on, little eyelashes, lipstick, and you know, whatever you put on, it makes you more attractive. You're very attractive, but you will make you even more attractive. Right? That's all we have to do. I don't mean we have to put makeup on Jesus Christ, but the way we live our lives should function like a makeup to enhance the beauty of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. How do we do that? You could go only so far with your knowledge, because you're going to encounter more knowledgeable people, but it's your experience, your personal experience, your personal encounter with your Lord and Savior. Every one of us should have some of those stories that we could share. That will become our cosmetics to shine Jesus Christ. Your personal devotion is important. Your worship is important. The way you pray is important. So all these things, you're acquiring more makeup, if you will, to make Jesus more attractive. When I was in high school, I attended this large school, about 2,500. Keep in mind, back then, they didn't have ninth graders as high school students. This is only 10, 11, and 12. So this is still a pretty big high school. Out of the student body, we only had 6 minorities. 1 African-American student and 5 Asians. One was my friend who recently came from Korea, so he couldn't really speak English well. So one time, he got into a verbal spat with one of the students. And so this student started lashing out some harsh words in English, which he couldn't understand, but he knew by the expression, this guy is not saying nice things. So my friend, he started shouting back in Korean, like saying all the bad words in Korean. And then that spread. So like, people start coming to my friend, hey, how do you say dumb in Korean? How do you say stupid in Korean? So a couple weeks later, everybody started saying all these things to each other. The popular phrase at that time was like, just 2 like American students, and then one is speaking Korean, bad words in Korean, and they're like, huh? What did you say? And then the popular saying was, it's for me to find out, and no, it's for me to know and you to find out. He would just walk away. This guy would be like puzzled, like, what just happened? So like, they're coming to me for all these things. That experience really just told me what we say really do matter. How we behave really do matter. Oh yeah, granted, to 6 minority students, so that everybody's gonna know what we say, what we do, pretty much. But isn't that kind of like us today? Whether we like it or not, if you tell other people that you're a Christian, well, guess what? Bam, there's a spotlight on you. And you have that responsibility to do the things, to say things, to highlight Jesus, to shine Jesus. When I was a teenager, there was a fair putting like a bumper stickers. Everyone had bumper stickers. No one does it anymore, but like, you know, parents would have, my son or daughter is honor roll student, and, you know, those kind of bumper stickers. And Christians would have their bumper stickers too. Jesus is Lord, you know, that kind of thing. So I thought it would be cool to have something representing Jesus, but not really saying Jesus. So you know those fish logo? I bought one of those and I put it on my car. And I was driving and, you know, I wasn't the most cautious driver, let's say. You know, teenager, I've known to speed a little, you know, do a little evasive maneuvers, a little faster than other people. So, like, people will honk at me. And I'll come home and go, what did I just do? I have a fish sticker. So I try to take that out, put it off. Because I know I was being a bad example. We have a responsibility. The way we live our daily lives, we have to make sure we find ways to shine Jesus. So Paul talks about older men and older women, younger men and younger women. Raise your hand if you think you're older men category. Okay, I see one person. Raise your hand if you think you're younger or older woman. Okay, so the way it works is that if we say, wow, you look so young, right? That's a compliment, and we are trained that way, and it does make you feel good, right? So when you see, you know, old person, like, wow, like, are you a high school student? You know, they, you know, everybody knows, we're just kidding around, but then that's a part of a compliment. What Paul is saying is different. This is what he says, this is what the Bible says in Leviticus chapter 19:32. Stand up in the presence of the aged. Stand up in the presence of the aged. Show respect for the elderly and revere your God. I am the Lord. There is no conditional clause here. It just says aged. You know what is understood here? Is that if you aged, you're supposed to live your life in such a way that will earn respect from other people. That's what the Bible means. When Paul's addressing this, it doesn't have to be age. I mean, he's talking about older person as an age. But spiritually speaking, for Christians, it's a compliment when someone says, wow, you look old. You know what I mean? Because old means what? You're mature. You're a little more mature than other, more complete. You know? You're closer to God than other people. So as we age, we have that natural response to be more closer to Jesus Christ, to act more like Jesus Christ. So you see, that's why we have to constantly grow in the Lord. And as we grow, we look back and we reach out to the younger generation. And we raise them as well. This is God's formula. In the church, that's why we need to have a multi-generational church where we could all help each other. When you're mentoring someone, you're propelled to do things better, to be more exemplary. And when you're younger, you seek out older people to be mentored. This is how it works in the church. I hope we could exercise this type of atmosphere and be blessed. And in today's passage, Paul talks about self-control a lot because it really requires enormous self-control to be led by the Spirit, to do this type of ministry. You can't go and share the gospel unless you're led by the Spirit. How can we be led by the Spirit? When you let go of yourself. It takes self-control. If I go to a buffet, I know I won't be able to exercise my self-control. I just know that. And knowing that, I just go to a buffet. Living in California for a long time, we'll go to Las Vegas. Not to gamble, but to eat, right? Because Las Vegas, if you stay in one of those hotels on the strip, well, guess what? Every single hotel has buffet. Some better than others, but every single hotel has one. So one time, we're staying at a hotel, I forgot which one, but then we got a package deal, all meals included. Breakfast, buffet. Lunch, buffet. Dinner, buffet. You go there for 3 days, you're going to come back like 10 pounds heavier. If you pay $100 for this, you know, expensive buffet, you're going to eat. You're going to lose your self-control. When we look other way, when we try to explore other things in life, there's a good chance we're going to lose our self-control. We could only regain this type of self-control when we are in God, when we are with God. So we have to exercise. We have to be in the right place. If you know you're going to lose your self-control, don't go there. I pray this is something that we would really focus on, to let go. One of the impactful words ever penned against the church is by Charles Schulz. Do you know who that is? He's the one who's responsible for Snoopy. Do you guys know who Snoopy is? Are you guys too young to know Snoopy? Yeah, so this is Snoopy, the dog, right? This particular episode, there's a Snoopy. This is not the exact one, but there's a Snoopy freezing because it's cold, it's snowing, and he has his food dish, and he's looking at the house for one of them to come out and to feed him, or better yet, invite him into the house, right? Because he's freezing outside. Lucy opens the door, and she shouts out, "Blessings! Be warm! Be filled!" And then she shuts the door behind. And then Snoopy sad and shocked, and she's still shivering. A lot of times, that's how Christians live their lives today. That will be us. Because a lot of people, even in Oklahoma, even in Edmond, a lot of people are not saved. And we see them, and we don't make that effort. Because often, it does require our effort. We have to reach out, we have to set aside our time, our energy, even our money. It requires some sort of sacrifice. And I'm going to say that's why so many Christians today don't do this. We could do other things. Hey, we come to church, you know, okay, I'll go. I will go worship and I'll attend Bible study. Okay, I'll go to the fellowship even. But that, well, let me think about it. Or better, let me pray about it. Because extra time, extra money, extra effort, and I could get rejected on top of it. So we don't go here. But this is something we have to decide. As a church, okay, God, we're willing to go there. Okay, I want to experience this. So unless you go here, all these things we do, it's not going to make a whole lot of sense. Like I said last week, we might as well join a country club. That's better. I'll be treated better. Yeah, I'll spend money, but you know, I'm going to eat good food. This is not a country club. We have to remember why we exist. If we want to be great in God's eyes, we have to focus on this, and that is a shame. We need to raise leaders who will be kingdom-minded, who will be mission-minded, who will lead us to this place. Just pray for that. And I'm looking forward to that, where we can experience this together, sharing Jesus Christ, some sort of platform, whether it be missions or community service or something, some kind of fellowship where we could reach out to other people who are yet saved, and yet we bring them to God. I look forward to that experience. And that's my prayer. I hope you get to experience that together. Then you will know what I mean. Then all these things we do, we make more sense. Father, we thank you so much. Thank you, Lord, for choosing us to be your children. We have eternal salvation, Lord. We have so many spiritual blessings that we cannot otherwise have. We became co-heirs with Jesus Christ. We are so thankful. Father, but for much is given, much is required. You call us to represent you, Lord. Even go to the ends of the earth to make disciples of all nations. But Father, help us focus on this mandate. Help us to experience you profoundly as we share Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Children coming with a special presentation. Thank you.
虽然叫一声妈妈只需要两个字，但妈妈用尽一生来爱我、呵护我、照顾我。
接下来我要邀请唯一一位儿童讲述三到四点妈妈如何爱我、照顾我、保护我。
My mom didn't do it. It was just when she teaches me, read Chinese and write.
My mom takes me to Tulsa on a car. He takes me on a plane. He often plays me a trophy.
My mom buys cakes for me. Also, she eats ice cream with me. He brings me to workout center.
My mom is always by my side, teaching me about God and things that I don't know and buying me things that I like.
My mom helps me with homework, good advice, tells me what is right and wrong, but what I have to do.
My mom helps me with homework.
My mom always cooks for me. Sometimes she teaches me how to cook. My mom always buy me toys for me, read and play with me.
My mom takes care of me and loves me no matter what, helping me when I'm sick and cooking for me even when she's tired.
Can you stand? We have a special gift. I do. I want to. Afterwards, we also have a video from youth group for Mother's Day. So.
Checking my Chinese word.
Getting ready for the piano class and making cake for me.
I'm grateful for my mom's cooking, the lessons she's taught me, the patience she's taught me, everything that she does for me. I just love her very much and I thank her for just being the best mom I've ever had.
I'm grateful for how she has cooked for me every morning for lunch. I'm grateful for her feeding us because she cooks for the family, and I'm very grateful for her.
She always cooks for me.
She always cooks for me. Every time I need something, she can always provide. If I want something, she wants to sometimes give it to me.
Probably complain a lot because when I was a kid, I'd complain a lot, but I feel like it's better now. That's what I would change.
There's times where I've been impatient and I've complained a lot, I think. I think that if I could go back in the past, I would understand that I don't have much time with Muhammad because I'm going to go off to college soon. So I would just be more patient with her now and complain less and just try to make her life easier because she's not so much for me. And that's it.
Thank you for always being caring and I will work hard in college.
Thank you for my life.
Would you like to say anything to your mom?
Thank you.
What the heck is that
What is your mom?
Okay, why did your viewer doesn't get those questions?
Okay.
After 6 months or so, it was not working. So I flew in from California to see her and to bring her to Texas, their Presbyterian hospital with a cancer specialist. So that turned out to be my last trip with my mom. She was in constant pain, so they were giving her morphine at the stage. So just sitting down was painful. But that drive was about 12, 13 hours drive. I remember my mom, she did not express any pain. It was as if she knew this might be her last trip and she wanted to make it enjoyable. She would just, you know, ask me, hey, do you want to stop for something to eat? Do you have to go to a bathroom break? You know, she would be thinking of me and the rest of us. And my thing was just go down as fast as I can so I could check her in so she could have, you know, pain medication and things like that. As I was saying goodbye to her, going back to California, she did something that I don't remember ever. I'm sure she did it when I was younger. But she grabbed my face, and she pulled me closer to her face, and she kissed me on my lips. And I thought that was kind of strange, because we never did that. I mean, we're not a very expressive family. We barely hug each other. But she kissed me. And I remember that. I kind of had a feeling, okay, this might be it. I might not be able to see her. One thing I wish I had done more was to hug my mom and kiss my mom more. On this Mother's Day, I hope you find time to go and hug your mom. Go kiss her. It's okay. And express your love. And that's all right. We're going to close today with the special prayer for our moms, and I'll end with benediction. So let's all rise and have a congregational prayer just for your moms. Let's pray out now for your mom. Pray for your mom. Pray for your friend's mom. Whatever. Let's pray for our moms, and then I'll close. Let's pray together. Gracious God, thank you so much. We love our Father, because they represent your amazing, unconditional, sacrificial love. We remember how, as you have heard, they cook for us, and some of them don't even enjoy cooking, and yet they cook for us because we need our sustenance, and they're willing to sacrifice. Father, it's not all, I'm just the tip of iceberg. They do more things for us. They stay up when we're sick, and they're in constant prayer for us, and we cannot express our love enough for their sacrifice. But Father, on this day, I just pray that you will reach out to them. You will just remind them that they are doing great things, that you will bless them. Whether they are real moms or stepmoms, it doesn't matter. If they're a mom, they're a mom. And I just pray, oh Lord, that you will bless them in a special way, that all of us children will be able to reach out to them and to express our love for them as well. May you bless this day, and may you highlight all the moms in the world. Oh Lord, thank you for our worship. It was different, but we know that you have been with us. We thank you, Lord, for accepting our worship. Even with some difficulties, oh Lord, I just trust that you were able to embrace us just as we are. So we thank you, Lord, for loving us unconditionally. Like our moms, oh Lord, help us to express our love freely with one another. Especially to our moms, oh Lord, let us, at least today, show them how much we love them. Now may the grace of God and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit be with all of us as we try to honor you and honor our moms. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You're dismissed. Have a great lunch for you.
Hey, you guys are staying, right?
No.
When was that?
Yo, it's been a minute.
I know, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good.
How's Malaysia been?
It's good.
Yeah, it's good?
Yeah.
Are you still teaching? Yeah, I am.
From where? Where are your parents from?
One was from Johor and the other was from Cebu. Yeah.
Have you been back recently?
I'm going next year, but the last time I went back was two years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's not too long.
We'll be there. We'll be back soon.
Okay, cool.
When are you going back?
I'm leaving. I'm going to Denver for a few days. So I'm going back to Malaysia on the 20th.
Oh, okay. So
a weekish.
Yeah, yeah. Are you looking forward to going back? Or?
half-half. I mean, I like
half,
it here. Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
I'm surprised.
It's like
I feel
good to
like,
be back.
I feel like everybody like that's Malaysian that comes here, they want to go back to Malaysia.
Really? Just a lot of people want to stay, but they do not.
Maybe
stay.
It's the younger guys.
Yeah,
like the older Malaysians, they probably like want to go back.
Really? Like Danny or Sam,
yeah,
they want to stay. Because
like the food is like better.
The food is better.
Yeah.
You're a senior.
I'm a.
In college?
Yeah, I'm a junior in college.
You go to
Emory.
Oh, you're just back here for
Yeah, I'm just here for the summer.
Yeah. So you go to Emory, okay.
Are you going to Ethan's graduation?
I'm not. It's on Monday.
Yes. I think it's tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Are you guys going to go? You're going to go?
I'm not going to fly back.
I love
Ethan and Grace.
Don't feel the need.
Do you hang out with them?
Yeah, I do hang out with them.
Okay. Thank you. JoJo.
JoJo is also going to Emory. Yeah. There's some bright kids.
You too.
No, I was a fluke. I was a mistake.
Really?
I got it on accident.
What are you studying?
Computer science.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a friend who's here. I need to bring him in.
Sounds good.
I'll talk to you later.
That's good. Catch you.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good to see you.
This is for our cell group. So make sure to get a head count for the student.
Oh, I got a head count. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Why not? Have
a sure.
Dana.
Sure.
Not?
Okay, sorry to bother you guys. But there's a sign up sheet in the back for this Saturday.
Oh, you're not gonna be here.
That's so sad. Timmy kind of texted me back.
Did you sign up?
Yeah, I think so. You do, right?
But I wonder what happened for Monica.
Yeah,
it
fine,
was okay,
right? I think it's probably when she disconnected, and then I don't know, maybe there's a misconnection.